right, so spotting bullshit, as you see, can be hard, and we're going to talk about some of the ways to do this. It's not that these are the only methods for doing it, it's that looking for bullshit in your media diet is a habit of mind that we all need to get into the practice of. And these are some of the things that Jevin and I are doing as we're reading the popular media, but also as we're reading scientific papers and those sort of things. So I'm going to start with the very start. Let's start out if a claim seems too good to be true. If a claim seems too good to be true or too bad to be true, it probably is, right? So let's jump right into an example. A friend of mine tweeted this a year ago, and I'll explain what this is. He was shocked when he saw a diagram that he found on the internet that there are very, very different uses of language when people write recommendation letters for men and for women. And so what this word graphic that he put together shows is, or is it claiming, is that, you know, when people write recommendation letters for men, they're using words like exceptional, remarkable, fabulous, extraordinary, unmatched. And for women, they're using words like dependable, conscientious, hardworking, colleague, communicate, citizen, these kinds of words. Huge, huge problem. But when I saw this, I was skeptical right away. Not because I don't believe that there are gender biases in academia. I do believe that. But the effect size here is extraordinary. I mean, could it really be that the words that are associated with men are all these sort of, you know, always so amazing words, and these words that are associated with women are all so, you know, she's hardworking and dependable. So the effect size that's jumping out here is enormous. And so I went to the original paper. And go to the original paper. Here's the original paper that he links to with the tweet. Paper says, overall, the results of the current study revealed more similarity in the letters written for male and female job candidates than differences. Letters written for women included language that was just as positive and placed equivalent emphasis on ability, achievement, and research. So the paper's conclusions are exactly opposite of my friend's tweet. That's interesting. So how did that possibly happen? Well, my friend had inadvertently tweeted a picture of the hypothesis, not of the results. So the researchers hypothesized that these words would be associated with males. These are what they called standout words, you know, amazing, fabulous, sick, you know, unparalleled, and so on. They hypothesized that these words here would be associated with females. These are what they called grindstone words, hardworking, dependable, reliable. And then they tested this hypothesis, and it turned out they didn't find evidence for this. So they rejected this hypothesis. But my friend didn't bother to look into this carefully enough, and he simply, you know, saw this, tweeted it out, and it took off on the internet. His tweet picked up over 2,000 retweets, right, and went absolutely viral. And it was a good illustration of Brandolini's principle, because if you clicked on his tweet and you go and look, we talked about Brandolini's bullshit asymmetry principle last week, how it's so much harder to dispel bullshit than it is to create it. And so if you click on this original tweet, you get this long, long comment thread of hundreds of people saying, you're a moron, that's the hypothesis, not the results of the experiment. Doesn't matter. Nobody clicks on that. They just see this, seems to say something to them, they retweet it. And this you know, idea goes spreading out across the internet. And I think part of the reason that, you know, this particular audience is so susceptible to that kind of mistake has to do with another one of the points. And this is this notion of being aware of confirmation bias. And confirmation bias is the idea that we tend to simply accept information that supports the views that we already have. A lot of us who've been in academia know firsthand that there is gender bias in academia. And so when we see something that indicates, a study that indicates, oh yeah, there's this gender bias, then we tend to say, oh, that must be right. You know, I know there's gender bias in academia, and then we want to share that and pass it along and so on. If I'd seen a study that said, you know, men are discriminated against in academia, I would have been perhaps much more likely to say, I can't be right, and then kind of dig in and question. People wouldn't have retweeted that. They'd question that. But one that, you know, says something that we all know or believe to be true is much less likely to be questioned. In fact, the only reason I questioned it was because I saw the effect size was so big, which brings us around to that first point. When you hear claims, if they seem too good or too bad to be true, dig in and question. And what I'd also like you to do is when you hear claims that agree with things you already believe, challenge yourself to question those and dig in and be skeptical of those just as much as you would as if the claim said something that you don't believe.